rest of you guys. What were you doing? It was raining while we missed you. On Wednesday, I started this series talking about looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. I'm going to continue in it part two today. Today we're just going to talk about looking unto Jesus for endurance. Because you know we need to endure in this time. So on Wednesday, I'm just going to review a little bit. We talked about the importance of looking into Jesus because we have a culture now where there's a pull to look unto everything else for the solution. There's a culture now where everybody in the world is opposing the things of God, and that it making it okay to oppose the things of God, making it okay to go ahead and have solutions based on what the world is doing, not based on what God is doing. It seems like there's a pull to live any kind of way that you want to live. It seems like the temptation is intensifying even more and more and more. The persecution is intensifying even more. So the believers are falling prey because of temptation. They're falling prey because of persecution. They're falling prey because they're thinking, God, you're taking too long. So let me go my own route because you're taking too long. Instead of saying love your enemies, instead of you following through to that word, you have a neighbor or coworker that say, I would not. You better get back at her. You gotta hit back at her. You better put a subliminal message on Facebook talking about her. Isn't that the truth? That's what's happening. It seems like everything, and it's not happening overnight. We're talking about believers. There's a falling away, as the scripture says. But the only way there could be a falling away if there's a neglect in the word. If there's a neglect of looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. You can only fall temptation to it if there's a neglect of the word of God. Because he said all of these things were going to happen. It says that men are going to be lovers of themselves rather than lovers of God. Lovers of pleasure. But he said, me, Jesus, in me you will have perfect peace. In this world you will have tribulation. Can we agree with that? Everybody in this room have gone through something, right? Everybody in this room have a temptation to do what's not right before God. And it's going to get worse and worse and worse. But if you don't look unto Jesus, you keep your focus on him regardless of what everyone else does. If you look at John, he's done this to you, or he promised to give you $10,000 for that business deal. If you're looking to him as your source and he changes his word, what is the solution? You're trying to get back at him. But if you look to God, God is going to use a man. God is going to use a man to use his power, his ability on your behalf. But you're looking to God, not the man, as your source. There's a pull to walk in offense still. The word of God says to go to the person and ask them to forgive you and let it go. But there's a pull to hold on to that. Believers falling prey to those things. The world is going to do what the world's going to do, which is sin, right? But we, the believers, are to do it God's way. Say God's way. We are the believers are to hold fast the confession of our faith without wavering. Because God, who has promised, is what? Faithful. You should know that. Let's go to Hebrews 10:23 for those of you that weren't here. Just a quick review so we can get into the new lesson. And if you don't have your Bibles, look onto the screen. It says, let us hold fast to the confession of our hope without wavering. For he who promised is what? It's right in front of you. Participate. Let's try it again. I'll give you guys another chance, just like Jesus. It says, let us hold fast to the confession of our hope without wavering. For he who promised is what?
Faithful.
He's what?
Faithful.
He's what?
Faithful.
He's what?
Faithful.
So he said, let us hold fast to the confession of our hope without wavering. So that means there was going to be an opportunity, a time, and a season for you to waver. But he's saying, hold fast to what I've taught you. Hold fast to what I've put in you. Hold fast to it no matter what comes, no matter what goes, no matter who comes, no matter who goes, no matter what the world is doing, no matter what the government is doing, no matter what your job is doing, your supervisor, your husband, your wife, hold fast to the confession of your faith. Because God, that is promised, he is faithful. We are not faithful sometimes, right? People go back on their word, but we cannot treat God like people. Because he is not people. He's already proven himself. Amen? Let's go to Proverbs 4:23. You're saying, well, how am I going to hold fast? How am I going to hold fast to the confession of my faith? How am I going to hold fast in the midst of dire circumstance, in the midst of when it seems like I'm losing? How am I going to hold fast to walking in forgiveness when this person or somebody so close to me stab you in the back? How am I going to hold fast when it seems like they're going to come get my house? The sign is on the door. How am I going to hold fast that he is the provider of my need? His provision shall be seen in my life. Thank you, Jesus. Proverbs 4:23 in the NIV version. It says, above all else, guard your heart, for everything you do flows from it. It says, above all else, guard your heart. It says, above all else, guard your heart. Out of it flows the issues of life, the New King James Version says. So how are you going to hold fast? By guarding your heart. Guarding your heart, the things that come in your heart to try to pull you away from what he said. You cannot allow that offense to stay in your heart. You have to guard your heart against it. Guard your heart about striking back. Guard your heart that you believe in God for your healing, and the enemy comes to tell you, no, you are not healed. You have to guard your heart against that. Guard your heart about lashing out. You know what? You got that report ready and somebody else got that credit. Guard your heart from having that resentment and bitterness. Because if you don't guard it, it's going to get in. And then your behavior will change. You're wondering, well, what happened? What happened? Neglect is what happened. Neglect to looking onto, neglect to loading your heart and deposit it in your heart. The Bible says that Jesus, he is the author and the finisher of our faith. He started it, he finished it, and in the middle of it right now, there is no shadow of turning in him. He's the author and the finisher of our faith. He's the perfecter of your faith. He already proven himself. All I got to do is focus my eyes on him. All I got to do is meditate on the word day and night. All I do is keep my eyes on him. All I do is keep my eyes, meditate, think about it, murmur it, say it, speak it, believe it in the midst of whatever is happening. Because we each have a track. We each have a life. We each have a journey. I got to think about it, meditate it, speak it, dream it, believe it. No matter what, winter, fall, summer, betrayal, loss of job, losing of home, marriage going through problem, believe it, say it, meditate on it. Because he who is promised is what?
Faithful.
He who is promised is what?
Faithful.
He who is promised is what?
Faithful.
Thank you, Jesus. So we're going to go into the new information. We know that there's nowhere in the scripture, and I've been saved a pretty long time, nowhere in the scripture where it says that you won't have trouble. There's nowhere in the Bible that it says when you become a Christian that nothing wrong will happen to you. But he did give us a promise. Life will happen to us as we are the very evidence of it. Things will happen to disappoint us as we are the very evidence of it. But if we keep our eyes on the one that has the solution, we will endure to the end and we will receive a crown, it says. Amen? John 16:33 in the Amplified Version. Look on the screen if you don't have it. For I have told you these things so that in me you may have perfect peace. In the world, you will have tribulation and distress and suffering, but be courageous, be confident, be undaunted, be filled with joy. I have overcome the world. Where is this peace that he's talking about? Where is it? It says that in me, you can have perfect peace. So he gave us full disclosure in the scripture saying that in this life, you will have tribulation. In this life, you will have opportunities and you will be discouraged. But he says, in me, though, hidden in me is the perfect peace. Your situation might not change yet, but you can be in the situation and you can have perfect peace. Why? Because he who is promised is faithful. And he knew that while we are in this world right now, we would need someone to lean on. We will need somewhere to go. Someone who has proven himself. Someone himself who walked the track and passed the test. So he said, in me. And some of you are thinking, I don't get that. What are you talking about, perfect peace? How can you have perfect peace in the midst of trials and tribulations? By keeping your eyes on Jesus. By keeping your eyes on the one who can fix it. By not looking at what you see or hear. Because if you look at what you see or hear, you will be moved. You will be shaken. But look at Jesus, and he was not shaken. He dealt with some of the same things we're dealing with. And he still kept the word of God on his mouth. I want it to be said of me. And we should be wanting to be said. Like Paul said, I have fought a good fight. I have finished my race. And I kept my faith. Don't you want that to be said of you? It says, I have fought a good fight. I finished my race and I kept my faith. I was not like a man double-minded. I kept my faith no matter what I see, no matter what I hear, no matter what happened. But how did he do that? Because he had God and he kept his focus. Let's go to Acts 20. I think you guys had it at the, right? Acts 20, verse 22. You can look on the screen. This is Paul speaking. And see, now I go bound into the Spirit to Jerusalem, not knowing the things that will happen to me there, except that the Holy Spirit testify in every city, saying the chains and the tribulations that await me. But he says, none of these things move me, nor do I count my life there to myself, so that I may finish my race with joy and the ministry which I've received from the Lord Jesus Christ. He's saying he already, like a full disclosure, the Holy Spirit already revealed to him, gave him an assignment, but told him, when every city that you're going to go to, there's going to be bounds and chains and persecutions that's awaiting you. But what did Paul say? None of these things move me. Why? Because he knew who sent him on assignment, and whatever is awaiting him, he's going to have a way of escape. Hallelujah. Say, none of these things. None of these things, none of these things move me. You cannot allow the trials of life to move you. You cannot allow the culture that's so opposing God to move you into now opposing God, not believing God, not trusting God. You can't allow, probably being lack right now. Maybe you had two incomes, now you have one. You can't allow that to move you from your place of belief, from your place of trust. Just say, this is only temporary. Only temporary. You believe that? Do you truly believe that? You get it in your heart and you just believe it. Let's go to Hebrews 12. No, this is not a shouting message, but I feel such an urgency in my heart the last couple of weeks that for this message of looking unto Jesus, of this message of focusing our eyes on the one that accepted the assignment to come down, put away his deity for a moment, put away being equal with God, put away using his power to get back at everyone, put away all of that, and he came down in human flesh to purchase our redemption. And it seems like we're getting our eyes off of him and our eyes on everything else, our eyes on every solution, like they did in the Old Testament. God is like, I want to be your God, and I want you to be my people. But they kept wanting to have a king. Just like he did now, he went, his son came, bled physically, mental pain, physical pain, emotional pain. And we have to keep our eyes. The world might go off. The world might want to take and say what they want to do. Live. It seemed like back in the day, if you wanted to do wrong, people used to hide to go do it. Get in this car, drop me off at this house, pick me up here, you know, hide. Now it's everybody wants to do everything right in front of. There's no decency anymore. And it's going to get worse. But we, the believers, have to shine that light of the gospel and say, I will not participate. Amen. Amen? Amen? Hebrews 12. Therefore, we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and sin which so easily ensnare us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. Looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and he sat down at the right hand of God. So I'm going to give you four keys to walking in endurance. Four keys to walking in endurance. First, as it says that, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses. So in this walk, in this track, we each has, like it says, let us each run with endurance the race that is set before us. That tells me that we each have our own race that we have to run. We each have a track that he has us on. I can't run yours, and you cannot run mine. Ours may at some time in a set come together because he wants us to fulfill his will together. But I have my race, and you have your race. So on this track, on this path that you say per se, what will you need? Number one, you will need the cloud of witnesses. That's what scripture talks about. What are the cloud of witnesses? First, you can find them in the Bible. You can go through all the Bible and you can find the witnesses of the works of the Father God. In the Old Testament and in, of course, the works of Jesus. You want an evidence? You want testimony? Go in the scripture. If there's something that's kicking your butt, kicking your, you know, say sickness and disease, go and see all where he healed those that were oppressed of the devil. The woman with the issue of blood, he healed. Go find a witness to what you are living right now. David, when everything was stripped from him, he came home and everything was gone. What did he do? He went and sought the Lord and said, Lord, what should I do? And God gave him an answer. That's a cloud of witness. That's looking unto Jesus, because you're looking unto how do I? A cloud of witness. Looking in your life, your own personal life. I'm not talking about your neighbor's life yet. I'm talking about your own personal life. Going back 10 years, going back 15 years, where in your life you can see when this was God. God delivered me. God made a way where there was no way. God rescued me when I did not even deserve to be rescued. God turned that situation around for me last minute, and I wasn't even prepared. God had mercy. Look in your life and find that cloud of witnesses. You need that on your journey. You need evidence. Why? To tell, remind yourself. When you're thinking, man, I don't have enough. They're talking about cutbacks at my job. What is that cloud of witness in your life that you can go back to and say, I remember when I was in, you know, 21 and I didn't have money to pay for my rent and God touched, but I tithe and I gave an offering and God saw fit to touch someone to just bless me. You say, God, if you did that back then, you can do it again. I believe that you are my provider. A cloud of witness. Or you can look and miss your church. Look and miss your job. Look and miss your family. Look in your church and see, my gosh, she went through it and the devil tried to take her with cancer, but look, she is now healed. She's walking in healing. She's walking in the liberty of God, a cloud of witness. You need that on your journey, and you need to refer to it often. Often, which is every day. Especially if you're in an intense situation, you need to refer to some. Then you don't need to know them personally. Just know their testimony. Just know their testimony. You know what the scripture says? That we overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. That's why you have to testify of what you came out of and what God did for you, so that when someone can reference that and say, man, if God can do it for her, he can do it for me. Say a cloud of witnesses. I'm giving you a good word. You're not saying amen as good as I'm preaching. Hallelujah. As the old folks say. When you're at home, and everything is quiet in the midst of the battle, you got to be able to respond back. You can't have the thoughts. You know how you can lay there or sit there and all these darts, all these negative thoughts, all these, it's not going to happen. You're not going to get out of it. You have to respond back. You can't just think it back. You have to speak it back. You don't cast out a thought with a thought. You cast out the thought with the word. You speak out of your mouth. I take every thought captive and I bring you right now into the obedience of Christ. I know sister such and such that she had cancer, she had diabetes, she had mental illness, and now I see her healed. So I know, God, that you're faithful. So guess what? I cast out that thought from my mind right now. Cloud of witnesses. Isn't that good? And the people you need to keep your eye on are not the people. We're not saying that they're perfect the way they ran their race. We're not looking for people that perfectly ran their ways. We're looking for those that endured, those that kept the faith. And maybe sometimes they slipped a little bit, but guess what? They got back up. Yeah. You can ask them, what did you do when you felt like stopping? Maybe you slowed down a little bit. What made you get back up? Your husband left you. And I saw that you still kept that smile on your face because you had some babies. How do you keep that joy, sis? Because maybe you're going through the same thing or something similar. Say a cloud of witnesses. Those are the people who have evidence. The second, I say consider the cloud. The first one is consider the cloud of witnesses. The second one is consider yourself. You have to consider yourself because you have to prepare yourself. Just like marathon runners, you ran how many marathons? Two marathon runners. She ran two marathons. So to say there's a marathon tomorrow, I can't just say decide in my mind, oh, yeah, I'm going to run that marathon, 26.2 miles, without preparing. Right? So just like the marathon runners, they have to prepare themselves. We, when we go on this path, on this track, to endure, we have to prepare. You can't just like, in the name of Jesus, yes, he's going to give me all what I need on the track to run 26.2 miles. You've never been in nobody's gym, nowhere. You never ran nowhere. You have not even power walked anywhere. But you're talking about you're going to run a 26.2 mile marathon. But you won't do anything natural. You will not be able to endure. So it is with us spiritually, in this path, in this life that we're living, in this world that's getting, as the scripture says, worse. You cannot think that you are going to endure it without being prepared. So just as a marathon runner have to prepare physically, they have to prepare mentally, they have to prepare in case this happens, how am I going to respond? In case I get a cramp, what am I going to do for my body? Okay, I start running inside, but at some point I need to start running outside so I can sense the atmosphere, I can sense the environment. How am I going to be able to adjust myself? We have to do that spiritually. You have to prepare your soul. You have to prepare your mind. You have to prepare your body. Your soul mostly is where we kind of faint. Because we all in our feelings. Because we haven't been redeemed yet. That's the last thing we'll wait for. When we meet him, our bodies will be redeemed. No sickness, no disease, no irritations, no frustrations. Hallelujah, Jesus. But until then, you will have the temptation to be frustrated, irritated, mad, sad, grieved. So in this life, you have to prepare your soul for this fight. Well, how do we prepare your soul, Lynn? By putting that word in there. By guarding that heart that comes against God. How do you prepare your soul? By saying no matter what, when your feelings come and you don't feel like reading the word, just say, no, I study to show myself approved to God. I study and meditate on the word day and night. So you are calm and quiet within me. You are calm and quiet within me. One day I had to leave a meeting. I left a meeting that was so intense that I felt like opening my mouth and saying things opposite and just going off for a little bit. How many of you ever felt like that? Ooh, Shonda. Yes. But I went into my car. We had a 15-minute break. And I said, calm. I'm quiet within me. Thank you, Lord God. A soft answer turns away wrath. I thank you that I am in control of my emotion. Nothing will move me away from my stable place in God. I have the peace of God that surpasses even my understanding. You are calm and quieted. Calm and quieted. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you. I tap right into it. Thank you. And I start worshiping. I start praising. That's how you prepare yourself. And you do that before there's a situation. You do that before anything. You prepare your soul so that when there is a situation, you might feel the pull to go there, but you already practiced. You just go ahead and push it into gear. You get that? We have to prepare our soul so that you can get all that weight off of you. So say you weigh 300 pounds. You can't go run a marathon just right now. Not judging or putting anything on anyone, but if you have not practiced, you can't think, let me just get on the track and I'm going to run that marathon. There's a conditioning that you have to do for your body to get out there. Same thing spiritually. Say same thing.
Same thing.
Say same thing.
Same thing.
The next one is running with patience. After you've prepared, after you have the cloud of witnesses that will help you, you're ready. And you're like, bam, I got this. I got this. Hallelujah. I'm preparing myself. You know, I know the word, you know, I'm speaking the word, and you know, everything's good, praise the Lord, everything's good. And you're thinking, you know what, I should be done by, you know, 4 o'clock, I should be done, I should be good. I mean, what is this? I should be good. You know, I'm saving to buy a house, and you know, by the end of the year, you know what, I'm good, I'm debt free. Or you know what, I put out the resumes, you know, within a month, I expect to have a good job, you know, a job making, you know, $70,000 an hour, benefits, everything, medical, vision, I mean, just everything. You'll take it? Okay, 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 I see you, I see you, I see you. So you like, I receive that. So you're like, Father God, I thank you. You're going into that interview and you're like, I mean, you just answering the questions like, woo! You call, they call, you know, made a decision. We decided to go with someone else. How are you going to respond? Are you still going to have that patience? Like, because God gave you a word. God said, I will supply. My provision shall be seen in your life. And God gave you that word. You have an assurance in your heart that, you know what, that job is mine. But you've been applying and applying and applying. It just seems, are you going to have that patience with what he told you? Because you started real good. You're like, ooh, ooh, thank you, Jesus. Ooh, I'm so happy, sister. Yes, praise the Lord. God is my provider. And then a month later, when I ask you, is it still going to be like, praise the Lord, sister, God is my provider? Are you going to be patient? Are you going to find that, because everyone, if they're running a race, and with a marathon runner, or if you're just working out at the gym, you know, praise the Lord, the first 10 minutes is warfare. For me at the gym, the first 10 minutes, I'm just casting and binding and loosing just to stay on the equipment. Thank you, Lord. This is good for me. Yes, yes. Hallelujah, hallelujah. That's warfare. But after that, you just get into that groove. I don't know what that's called, where you just get into that groove and your body is like, this is what we're doing. This is what we're doing. You find your pace and you just stay. And you just stay patient. You're not looking at, you know, miles that just like. You're not looking at miles that seems like, you know, he comes and he goes past you. You're like, you know what? I have my own race. I found my pace. I'm just going to buckle down. You know what? And if he comes past me, I'm just going to be like, go, Miles. Woo, woo. And you're just going to keep going. Because we're not in competition. If he can do it, guess what? I'm going to get to your pace soon, buddy. You better watch out. But I'm not in competition with you. Because if I'm so focused at what you're doing on your lane, I get distracted. And before you know it, I'm off of my lane. Ooh. Be patient with yourself. Be patient with yourself. Be patient with what God is doing in you. Not looking at what he's doing in someone else and comparing that to where you are in God. Let the Holy Spirit do that. Say, let the Holy Spirit. Do it.
Do it.
Because the times and the seasons are in his hands. And I just have to remain patient and hold fast to his word. And say, Lord, it may have taken this person a year, but it's taken me, it seems like it's 2 years for this to manifest. But I'm not going to go and get in comparing myself with others. I trust you. And how many of you have had things that happened in your life and you look back and you thank God that it took that long? Because in it taking that long, there's something that you needed to let go of. There's a situation that was not perfect for you. So if you're not so patient, if you rush into it, you can damage yourself. Like because this happens to me. God is helping me. If I go to the gym and I find my pace, I'm working out, someone comes and they start running real like they're us all here. I'm just a super gym person. I'm just so awesome. You know, I will have the temptation to try to keep up with them. I'm like, you're not going to outdo me. You know, we can't do that spiritually. You hurt yourself doing that. And one time I did. The next day I was like, Jesus, Father God, that was not good. Because if you look good, guess what? And you're part of the kingdom, I look good.
Yes. That's right.
If you look good, we all look good. The kingdom looks good. We're just like, praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. I use you as a marker that God is still in the blessing business. Yes. I'm just going to be patient. I don't understand, Lord Jesus, why it's taking that long. But I know it's in your hand and I trust you. I'm not going to look to the left. I'm not going to look to the right. I'm going to keep my eye focused on you. Say amen.
Amen.
And the last one, we're going to consider his race. Because we've been talking about looking onto Jesus. We're going to consider his race. How did he run his race? Because he gave away his reputation. He gave away his deity. To come here and be a man in the flesh just like us. So he was in the position that we are in right now, where he just had to obey what the Father had told him to do. He had to fulfill the assignment that the Father sent him to do. And on his track was betrayal. On his track was pain, emotional pain, physical pain for a long projected time. On his track, the very people that he came to deliver spitting in his face, lying, tricking, setting him up. He knew this was going to happen when he came here. On his track was all of that. But he still chose to come down, and he still finished his race without speaking a word against us. And he said, Father, I have finished what you told me to do. Thank you. I have finished what you told me to do. Only one time the scripture says that he said, Lord, is there any other way? He asked him if there was any other way, but he wasn't going to stop doing it the way that the Father wanted him to do it. So on your track, there might be pain. On your track, there might be disappointment. So I would ask you to refer to the ultimate perfecter, the ultimate winner of the race, the ultimate finisher of the race. Look at how he did it. Did he always refer to the Father? Did he go away to the Father and receive strength when he was weak? Did he go ask for prayer? And actually, he went for prayer and said, can you pray for me? And they couldn't pray for a little bit of time. So consider the author and the finisher of our faith. It says he's the author and the finisher, the perfecter of it. And that's the person you can look to. Because if I keep my eyes on you and how you run your race, I might get discouraged. I might get disappointed. I will look and glean from something good you're doing. But I can't look and keep my eyes on the negative things that you're doing or the negative things people are doing. I keep my eyes on how did he respond in this situation? How did he speak back in this situation? How did he go in a situation? And the scripture says, all over the scripture, he says that Jesus, already knowing what they were going to do, having dinner with someone that you know will betray you. Are you going to tell them off? Give them a little piece of your mind? Or are you going to say, go do what you're supposed to do? Because I know if you, because everybody has an assignment. It's based on who you're listening to. Some people listen to the devil and some people listen to God. But if you're listening to the devil, guess what? You are listening. You are meant to do that. Go do it, because I know God already has a way of escape for me. I'm not going to be discouraged. I'm not going to faint, because I know there's a way of escape. If I keep my eyes on him, I know I will recognize the way out. So consider his race. Consider when he was on the cross. And physically, can you imagine? With all the movies that we can have some imagination of how bad that thing hurt. But do you know what? He kept thinking about you. He kept seeing our faces. He kept seeing us, him taking the keys from the devil. He kept seeing that I will have them, they will be free from sin forever. And so he stayed up there for the joy that was set before him. He endured. What is the joy that's set before you in your personal life? What is the joy that's set before? What is the end goal that he has told you? What is it? You keep that in your mind so that you can endure. That home that you've always wanted, your family that you want saved. Can you endure the persecution from them, knowing that, you know what, you're going to come to yourself? You're not yourself right now, but I'm going to treat you like you are in the name of Jesus. You might be rejecting God, But you're not rejecting me personally. It's all about God. I'm going to keep loving you. I'm going to keep speaking life over you. With that person at the job that keeps taking like they did that report, but it was both of you. Just say, Father God, in your time, I know that the truth shall be revealed. I'm not going to go have revenge. I'm not going to sneak around. You are going to make this right. That's what Jesus did. He did not revile for reviling. He did not speak evil. The scripture says a soft answer turns away wrath. Be slow to speak, quick to hear. That's how he did it. So in the end of this message, I want you to focus on, if you need to, if you haven't, or if you had a misstep, just make the adjustment. I don't need to tell you what's all happening in the world. You can see it for yourself. Not just in the United States. This is a world change. Because it's in preparing for our Savior to snatch us out. And so the things that are going to intensify, but we, the believers, have to hold fast to what we know. And if you haven't been depositing the word inside of you, I would encourage you, start today and start depositing the word inside of you. Start studying more than you have before. Start praying more than you have before. Start spending time with the ones you love and making sure they know about God, giving an invitation to people about God so that you can go ahead. We need to evangelize more than ever before. Because we will endure till the end. We will receive a crown. It says, if I endure, I will receive a crown. And we have angels all in our path encouraging us, hearkening to the word of God, hearkening to what? So I have full support. You're not out there by yourself. You have full support. You have the angels like, come on, girl. You can do it. Run that race. Okay, you fail a little bit. Get back up again. Guess what? You know what? Nobody sees that. The blood covered it. Let's go. Let's go. Let's go. Let's go. You understand? So if you fall into something because your eyes was on a man, and then you're like, that's how good the Holy Spirit is. He said, we'll fix it. Okay, just get back right. He's not going to say, I told you so at mile 19. I told you that man was going to come, and you did not listen to me because you were so lonely. You know, I told you to be prepared. And then you fell for it, or vice versa, man for a woman. But he's like, you know what? Just get back up, get back up, get back up, get back on it, get back on it. Let's just keep running. You have a testimony, help somebody else on mile 22. Do you see that? Because we're keeping our eyes on him. Yes. Praise the Lord. Everybody bow your heads. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Whoo! Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Father God, we thank you right now in the name of Jesus. Whoo! Thank you, Lord. I pray this word right now in the name of Jesus that the believers that are in this place right now and that will watch or listen to, Lord, that we will make the adjustment where we need to make the adjustment. No longer will we delay doing what you have called us to do. No longer we will allow the pull of the world to permeate our hearts, but we will allow your word to permeate in our minds and in our hearts and in our soul. Instead of looking to man for our source of supply, we will look to you, Lord. Help us, Lord God. And for those that are in this room right now, if you need to make an adjustment, I ask you to make the adjustment right now. Because it's not a season for us to delay making that adjustment. It's not a season and a time for you to say, I have more time. I need to do this first. I need to do that first. I would ask you to look around you. There is no time. Make the adjustment today. And I don't care who you are in this room. If you said, Lynn, I need to adjust. I need to start looking unto God. We can pray for you now. And as we did first service, there's some that came forward. We're going to ask you to come forward too if you need to make the